मेरी तरफ से ऑन है। अब क्लैपिंग के बाद हम स्टार्ट करेंगे। हेलो एवरीवन, सो नाउ लेट्स डिस्कस द ड्रग ट्रीटमेंट एंड मैनेजमेंट ऑफ ट्यूबरक्यूलोसिस। वी नो दैट ट्यूबरक्यूलोसिस इज कॉज्ड बाय अ बैक्टीरिया नोन एज माइकोबैक्टीरियम ट्यूबरक्यूलोसिस। ओके, एंड द ड्रग्स विच वी यूज फॉर द ट्रीटमेंट ऑफ ट्यूबरक्यूलोसिस आर नोन एज ATT। ATT स्टैंड्स फॉर एंटी ट्यूबरकुलर थेरेपी। ओके, नाउ लेट्स फर्स्ट क्लासिफाई द ड्रग्स फॉर एंटी ट्यूबर फॉर द ट्रीटमेंट ऑफ टीबी। लेट्स क्लासिफाई ATT। Okay, let's see the classification of drugs for TB. The first class of drugs for tuberculosis are known as first line drugs. And these drugs are 4 H, R, Z, and E. So these symbols we have to remember. H stands for isoniazid. R for rifampicin, Z stands for pyrazinamide, and E stands for ethambutol. Okay, now all these drugs we will write are oral drugs. All these drugs are oral drugs. And these drugs are given for new case of TB. Okay. Next point, all these drugs are cidal drugs. They are bactericidal except ethambutol. Ethambutol is a bacteriostatic agent. Okay, so this is an important question. So which first line drug in tuberculosis is bacteriostatic? The last one, ethambutol. Now we will write the most effective drug. Most effective drug for TB is a combination of isoniazid plus rifampicin. Okay, and even we have to choose among them. The most effective drug for TB is rifampicin. Okay, and remember, the combination of isoniazid with rifampicin is a synergistic combination. They show synergism. That means when we combine these drugs, their activity increases. Now, when a patient is H plus R, when a TB becomes H plus R resistant, this type of tuberculosis is known as MDR-TB. MDR stands for multi drug resistant TB. Okay, it is known as multi-drug resistant TB. But you have to remember, we start MDR treatment. We start MDR treatment only if there is rifampicin resistant. Only in R resistance, we will start the treatment of MDR TB. But the definition is H plus R resistance, but the treatment we will start if there is only rifampicin resistance also. Okay, now let's see what are the drugs we have for MDR-TB. Now the drugs for MDR-TB are known as second line drugs. And these second line drugs, they are divided into three groups. They are divided into four groups: group A, group B, group C, and group D. Okay, now among group A, we will write, we have fluoroquinolones. These fluoroquinolones are oral drugs and they are highly effective drug, hence we will write they are bactericidal drug. Okay, now which fluoroquinolone we will use? We will write OMGL, stands for ofloxacin, moxifloxacin, gatifloxacin, and levofloxacin. Now we will write that fluoroquinolone, which fluoroquinolone is most effective against TB? Most effective against TB is moxiflox. Gatiflox is not available in India. It has been banned. And levofloxacin is the most commonly used. Most preferred is levofloxacin. But the most effective is moxifloxacin. Gati is not available. Second, we will write group B. Group B are injectable drugs. And their mechanism of action is they are aminoglycosides. So how they are given? They are given by injection and they are also highly effective drug. Now which aminoglycosides we use? We'll write SAC. First is streptomycin, amikacin, capreomycin, and kanamycin. Okay, now what about streptomycin? Streptomycin is a supplemental drug. It is given as an add-on drug to first line drug HRZD. Amikacin is the most effective aminoglycoside against TB. It is even effective against streptomycin resistant cases as well. Capreomycin is not an aminoglycoside in structure, but the action is just like aminoglycoside, and kanamycin is the most preferred agent. So most commonly we use kanamycin. Now we will write group 3. Group 3 are known as other core agents. Okay, now these drugs are oral drug and these drugs are bacteriostatic drugs. So among first line, ethambutol was bacteriostatic. Now the second bacteriostatic agent we are writing is group C. So we will write their name. The mnemonic is CYCL. CY stands for cycloserine, C for clofazimine, which is also used in leprosy, L for linezolid, and E for ethionamide. Now, when you combine two molecules of cycloserine, it will become terazidone. So terazidone is nothing when two molecules of cycloserine are combined together. And we have a prodrug of ethionamide known as prothionamide. It has better oral absorption, hence we have made it. Okay, so these are group C agent. Now we will write group D. Group D are known as add-on drug. So they are never used alone. And they are add-on drug in MDR and XDR TB, which we will discuss. Group D are divided into three types. D1, D2, D3. In D1, we have old drugs. We'll write isoniazid. In high dose, pyrazinamide and ethambutol. Group D2, they are new drugs for TB and they are very important. There are two new drugs which have been approved. The first one is bedaquiline. And the second one is delamenid. So it's very important to remember their name. They are the new hope for the treatment of TB. And D3, the drugs we are having have unproven efficacy. We don't know whether they are effective or not against TB, but as we are out of options, hence we will write group D3. The drugs we will write are PAIMT. P stand for PAS, para amino salicylic acid. A for amoxicillin with clavulinic acid. I for imipenem. It is combined with a molecule cilastatin. Meropenem. And lastly, thioacetazone. Okay. Now, what are the new drugs for TB which are under trial right now, not approved? The first drug we will write, a congener of delamenid. The drug is pretomenid. A congener of linezolid, known as sutezolid. A congener of rifampicin, rifapentin. So these are under trial to see whether they are effective in TB or not. Okay. So this completes the classification of TB. Now let's see what is the treatment or management of TB. So let's see the management of TB. Management of tuberculosis. Now we will write, if a new case of TB comes to us, we start first line drugs. And these first line drugs, remember, they are given in two phases. One is intensive phase, which is given for 4 months, which is given for 2 months. Then we have continuation phase, is given for 4 months. So can we say that the total duration of treatment of TB is 6 months? Okay. Now, which first line drugs we use? We use all four first line drug, HRZE. Okay. And they should be preferred to take daily. There is a provision of alternative day treatment. That means we will miss the dose next day, and every alternative day we will give a drug. But that alternative day regimen nowadays is less preferred. We prefer to give a drug daily because alternative day regimen can lead to emergence of resistance. And here we will write HRE for 4 months. Okay. Now, what do you mean by Let's talk about resistance in TB. Resistance in TB, drug resistance in TB. So the first point we will write in drug resistance in TB, is monodrug resistance. Mono drug resistance. Okay, now mono drug resistance means resistance to any first line drug which we have written. Any first line drug except rifampicin. Because if it will be rifampicin, we will start the treatment of multi-drug resistance. So what is the treatment? The treatment is give intensive phase and continuation phase. Intensive phase is given for 3 months. Continuation phase is given for 6 months. So the total duration will become 9 months. Now, in intensive phase, we will keep on giving the drugs like, which are not resistance, HRZE. And if there is a resistance to any one of the drug, we will not give. Okay, if there is any resistance to one of the drug, don't give that drug. Instead of that drug, among H, Z and E, if there is a resistance, we will add levofloxacin and which is given orally, and we will add kanamycin which is given by injection. In continuation phase, we will keep on giving HRZE. And if there is resistance to any one of them, don't give. And add levofloxacin. Don't give kanamycin. Okay. Second, we will write polydrug resistance. In polydrug resistance, there is resistant to two or more than two drugs. Among HRZE, but exception is except combination of H plus R, because if there is combination of H plus R, they are the most effective drug for TB. That TB has a separate name that is known as MDR TB. Okay, so what is the treatment? The treatment is same, intensive phase for 3 months, continuation phase for 6 months, and hence the total duration again will become 9 months. Now what are the drugs? Keep on giving the drugs which are sensitive. Among HRZE, which are sensitive, keep on giving. Which are resistant, don't give. And you will add levoflox oral, kanamycin injectable, and we will add ethionamide from group C. In continuation phase, keep on giving HRZE, which is sensitive, and keep on giving levofloxacin and ethionamide. Don't give the injections of kanamycin, which is not given in continuation phase, kanamycin. Now let's talk about third type of resistance known as MDR-TB. MDR-TB stands for multi-drug resistance, and the definition of multi-drug resistance is H plus R resistance. isoniazid and rifampicin resistance, but we start the treatment in R resistance only. If there is resistance to rifampicin, start the treatment. Let's see what is the treatment. We give intensive phase, which is given for at least 6 months, and we give continuation phase for 18 months. So the total duration becomes at least 2 years or 24 months. So MDR-TB, 2 years. Now, here we will give, six drugs for 6 months. Here we will give four drugs for 18 months. Okay. So we will keep on giving the first line drug Z and E. And we will add four more drugs and make a mnemonic Zelec. Z stands for pyrazinamide, ethambutol, levofloxacin, ethionamide, cycloserine, and kanamycin. Kanamycin is given by injection. While those four drugs which we give, we will omit Z and we will omit kanamycin. Hence, the treatment will become ELEC. Okay. So don't give pyrazinamide and don't give kanamycin. Let's talk about the next, even more dangerous one, known as XDR-TB. XDR stands for extremely drug resistant TB. Now, what is the definition? XDR is MDR plus, MDR stands for H plus R resistance, plus fluoroquinolone resistance, which is group A, and injectable aminoglycoside resistance, which was group B. And you will write all drugs. So this TB bacteria is resistant to all fluoroquinolone and all injectable group B drugs. Okay. So what is the treatment of XDR-TB? For XDR-TB, we give treatment intensive phase for 6 months at least. Continuation phase for at least 18 months. Okay. And here we will write the names of the drug: Cipla, CM. Cipla, CM. So here we are giving 7 drugs. Okay. So the drugs are clofazimine, isoniazid in very high dose, pass paraminosalicylic acid, linezolid, amoxicillin, clavulinic acid, capreomycin, which is given by injection, and moxifloxacin. Okay, now here we will write Cipla M. So here we are giving 6 drugs. So which drug we have omitted? We don't give injectable drug. Rest all other drugs are same. This is the treatment of XDR-TB. Now, we know that MDR-TB is given for, if you have seen MDR treatment, it was given for 24 months. Taking a drug on continuous basis for 2 years, the patient will forget to take a tablet. Why? Because for 2 years you are continuously giving a drug, hence there is a compliance issue. Hence we have a new treatment for MDR. That new treatment for MDR is known as shorter MDR treatment. Shorter MDR TB treatment. Now this shorter MDR TB treatment, remember, it is given not for 24 months, it is given for just 9 months. Okay. It is only given in cases of pulmonary TB, lung infection. Remember, it is not given in extrapulmonary. And you have to rule out pregnancy. It is not given in pregnancy. Okay. Now, let's see what is the treatment. Intensive phase for 4 months. Continuation phase for 5 months. Hence, the total duration will become 9 months. Let's see what are the drugs. We'll write Mike PCP. Mike PCP. So here we are giving 7 drugs. So we'll write moxifloxacin, isoniazid, kanamycin, ethambutol, pyrazinamide, clofazimine, and lastly prothionamide. In continuation phase, we only give 4 drugs. MPEC. 4 drugs. Moxifloxacin. Pyrazinamide. Ethambutol. And clofazimine. Clofazimine. Okay. So these are the various guidelines for the treatment of tuberculosis. Now let's see tuberculosis in special scenarios. So let's see treatment of TB in special scenarios. And we have assumed a new case of TB is coming. Okay. So first special scenario is tuberculosis in pregnancy. Remember, in pregnancy, streptomycin and pyrazinamide are contraindicated. Okay. Now, streptomycin is contraindicated worldwide in all countries. Pyrazinamide is contraindicated in America, India. But in European nation, people, they give pyrazinamide. But in our country and in America, pyrazinamide is not given. So what is the treatment? The treatment we will write is among HRZE, the only treatment which is left is HERHER. Okay. Isoniazid, ethambutol and rifampicin. And here the treatment should be given for 9 months. Treatment should be given for 9 months. You have to add vitamin B6. That is pyridoxin, which is given with isoniazid, and it is mandatory. Okay. Second scenario. Second scenario, we will write of TB prophylaxis, prevention of TB, which is specially given in cases of neonate, of a tubercular mother, HIV individuals, immunodeficient individual, which have recent MONTU conversion or MONTU positivity, okay, and many other conditions. Now let's talk about what is the drug of choice. The drug of choice for tuberculosis prophylaxis is isoniazid, which is given as at a dose of 10 milligram, and it must be given for 6 months. This is the drug of choice. So drug of choice for tuberculosis prophylaxis is isoniazid, and in some countries it can be given up to 9 months as well, but isoniazid for 6 months is the drug of choice for TB prophylaxis. But what are the other drugs which we can give? We can give rifampicin for 4 months. We can give isoniazid and rifampicin combination for 3 months. But the most widely used method of prevention of TB is isoniazid for 6 months. Okay. Third point, we will write tuberculosis in HIV. Tuberculosis in HIV individual. In countries like India, the most common opportunistic infection in HIV individual is tuberculosis. Okay, but in other countries where the prevalence of TB is very less, like in America, the most common opportunistic infection in HIV is pneumocystis. Now, if a patient of TB with HIV comes, what disease should be treated first? Remember, first we always treat opportunistic infection. So first you will give ATT, anti-tubercular therapy. Okay, first you will start anti-tubercular therapy, and after 8 weeks you will start the treatment of HIV also. The drugs for HIV are known as ART, anti-retroviral therapy. Okay. Now the point is, what is important, we know that in tuberculosis we use a drug rifampicin. There is a problem with rifampicin, that rifampicin is a CYP enzyme inducer. Because of this reason, it can increase the degradation or metabolism of HIV drugs. Hence, the HIV drugs will lose their effectiveness. They will lose their effect because they will get rapidly degraded by CYP enzyme. So let's see which anti-retroviral drug should not be combined with rifampicin. Now in anti-retroviral or anti-HIV drug, we mainly use three categories. The first is NRTIs. Example, many drugs are there like zidovudine, etc. NNRTI. Now there are two drugs we will write in NNRTI. One is efavirenz. Second is nevirapine. Okay. That is, NNRTI is non-nucleoside reverse transcriptase inhibitor. NRTIs are nucleoside reverse transcriptase inhibitor. And the third class of drug we are having is protease inhibitor. All protease inhibitor, they will end with the word navir, like ritonavir. Example, ritonavir. Now, if you have to combine rifampicin with HIV drugs, you will write, with rifampicin, you can combine NRTIs. It is easy to combine NRTI, no problem. And you can combine efavirenz with rifampicin. But we will write that nevirapine should not be combined with rifampicin, and protease inhibitors also should not be combined with rifampicin, because rifampicin increases the degradation of nevirapine and protease inhibitor. Okay, so it's best to avoid nevirapine and protease inhibitor. But if there is some compulsion that you have to give nevirapine or protease inhibitor, in that case, nevirapine and protease inhibitor, they can be combined with rifabutin. They can be combined with rifabutin, because rifabutin is not a CYP enzyme inducer. It will not increase the degradation. So if you have to combine nevirapine and protease inhibitor, change rifampicin to rifabutin. Okay, change rifampicin to rifabutin. Now let's talk about last point in management of TB, that is corticosteroids in TB. Corticosteroids in tuberculosis. Now, remember, corticosteroids, they inhibit fibrosis or stricture formation. Hence, it is mandatory to give corticosteroid in tubercular meningitis, pleural TB, pericardial TB, genitourinary TB. Okay. Second point, corticosteroid, they are also given when there is some hypersensitivity to anti-tubercular drugs or anti-tubercular therapy. Now, there are certain tuberculosis in which you will never give corticosteroid. You'll write corticosteroids, they are absolutely contraindicated in intestinal TB. Example, ileocecal TB, any area. Because here, if you will give corticosteroid, fibrosis will not occur, and TB will kill the intestine and perforation can occur, and it will lead to silent, because there will be no inflammation because of corticosteroid, and it will lead to perforation. So in which tuberculosis corticosteroids are never given? That is intestinal TB. Secondly, you will also write it should not be given when the TB is spreading actively. Corticosteroids should be avoided in primary progressive TB. Okay, primary progressive TB. But what is expected? That corticosteroid are never given in intestinal tuberculosis. Because of inhibition of fibrosis, it will lead to perforation of intestine. And this is all about the management of TB. So now let's start with the individual properties of anti-tubercular drugs. So let's talk about anti-tubercular therapy. Let's talk about these drugs one by one. So cut hai. Chalo, theek hai, ab taali ke baad start karenge. So now let's start with individual anti-tubercular drugs. Okay. So first of all, we will start with first line drugs for TB. First line drugs. Okay. Now remember, there are four first line drugs. HRZE, that is isoniazid, rifampicin, pyrazinamide and ethambutol. Okay, now there is a supplemental drug which is known as streptomycin. So which is the supplemental drug? Supplemental drug is streptomycin. While first line drugs are H, R, Z and E. Okay, so let's start individually with all these five drugs. So let's make a heading, isoniazid. Let's make a heading, isoniazid. Now, what is the mechanism of action of isoniazid, which is denoted by the symbol H? We will write the mechanism of action. Now, isoniazid, first point, it is a prodrug. It is a prodrug. This isoniazid enters into the bacteria of tuberculosis. It enters into TB bacteria and it gets converted into active form. And there is an enzyme which converts it into active form present in TB. That enzyme is catalase peroxidase. So which enzyme converts catalase peroxidase into active form? And this enzyme in TB is produced by a gene. That gene is known as CAT G gene. Okay. Now when this isoniazid is converted into active form, its main mechanism of action is it inhibit mycolic acid synthesis. Now mycolic acid is the cell wall of TB bacteria. That is why TB bacteria got its name, Mycobacterium. Now there are two proteins which it inhibits in this cell wall. The first is INHA protein and second is Cas-A protein. And this is the main mechanism of action of isoniazid. Now isoniazid has one more mechanism of action. It also inhibit dihydrofolate reductase enzyme, DHFR enzyme. Because of this reason, it also inhibits cell division. So if folic acid is not synthesized, it will inhibit the DNA replication. But the main mechanism of action is it inhibit mycolic acid synthesis by inhibiting INHA and Cas-A protein. Okay, and it is a prodrug. So all these are very important questions. Now the second point arises, why does a TB bacteria becomes resistant to isoniazid? So why there is resistance to isoniazid? Because of mutation in CAT G gene. So TB bacteria form some different type of catalase peroxidase which will not activate isoniazid from its prodrug form. Okay, and the second mechanism of resistance, we will write, there is mutation in INHA protein. There is mutation in INHA protein gene. Okay, INHA protein gene. Now there is a similar anti-tubercular drug which also inhibit INHA protein. That anti-tubercular drug is ethionamide. Mechanism of action of ethionamide is same like isoniazid. Ethionamide also inhibit INHA protein. That is why ethionamide shows cross resistance with isoniazid. Okay. Ethionamide shows cross resistance with isoniazid. Now let's talk about the properties, pharmacokinetic properties of isoniazid. We will write, isoniazid is given orally. It is a CYP, that is cytochrome P enzyme inhibitor. Remember, rifampicin is a CYP enzyme inducer. Isoniazid is inhibitor. It inhibits all CYP it inhibit all CYP except CYP2E1 it induces. Okay, so it increases the activity of CYP2E1, and we have discussed already that CYP2E1 induction leads to paracetamol hepatotoxicity. It increases the risk of paracetamol hepatotoxic potential because of induction of CYP2E1, because CYP2E1 converts paracetamol into an toxic metabolite known as NAPQI, which was already discussed. Now, next point we will write that isoniazid itself is metabolized or degraded in our body by a process known as acetylation. And to do acetylation, our liver has an enzyme known as NAT enzyme. NAT stands for N-acetyl transferase. Now, this acetylating enzyme, NAT enzyme, it shows marked genetic variation. That means in some individual, this acetylating enzyme is present in higher quantity. In some individual, it is present in lower quantity. In those individuals where it is present in high quantity, those individuals are known as fast acetylators, because they will very rapidly metabolize isoniazid. And some individuals have low amount of this enzyme, they are known as slow acetylators. Now what about Southeast Asia region like India? Remember, most of the Indians are slow acetylator. 2/3 of the Indians are slow acetylator. And most of the Americans are fast acetylators. Most of the Indians are slow acetylator. Now, we will write that in fast acetylator, isoniazid produces a side effect. Because it gets very rapidly metabolized in liver, when it gets rapidly metabolized in liver, it damages liver there only. Hence, in fast acetylator, isoniazid produces hepatotoxicity. In fast acetylator, hepatotoxicity. While in slow acetylator, isoniazid get accumulated in the body and it damages nerves, it produces neurotoxicity. Okay, now how this neurotoxicity is manifested? So can we say that most of the Indians with isoniazid, they suffer from neurotoxicity, and this neurotoxicity manifests as, in periphery, they damage neuron, which leads to peripheral neuropathy. While in brain, CNS, it can produce seizures. It can produce psychosis. And it can produce transient memory loss. It produces transient memory loss. So this neurotoxicity is a very important side effect that you must remember. Now, basic question arises that why does it damages neurons? It damages neurons because it inhibits certain enzymes in neuron. Isoniazid inhibit pyridoxine dependent enzyme in neurons. So the question arises that how would you treat the neurotoxicity due to isoniazid? The treatment of neurotoxicity is pyridoxine, which is also known as vitamin B6. For treatment, we give the dose of 100 mg. And for prevention of neurotoxicity, again we give pyridoxine, but in a dose of 10 mg. So both for treatment and prophylaxis of neurotoxicity due to isoniazid, we give pyridoxine or vitamin B6. Now let's see what is the use of isoniazid. Isoniazid is only used in TB. Now in TB, we will write that isoniazid It is the most effective drug and it is a drug which decreases bacterial load fastest. Because of this reason, this isoniazid, when given in a TB patient, will rapidly reduce the number of bacteria. It makes a tubercular patient non-infective to others. Second, isoniazid is also the drug of choice for prophylaxis of TB. And this isoniazid for prophylaxis should be given for at least 6 months. Okay. Now let's see the side effects of isoniazids. Side effect of isoniazid. We will write a mnemonic for it. The mnemonic is no hashtag. Okay. So N stands for it produces neurotoxicity. And we know why, because it is inhibiting pyridoxine. Now this neurotoxicity occurs very commonly if a patient is already deficient in pyridoxine or vitamin B6. So the risk of neurotoxicity increases in malnutrition, diabetes mellitus, anemia, and slow acetylators, which we have already discussed. Second, it can cause optic neuritis. Now, this optic neuritis is a very rare side effect of isoniazid. Remember, if optic neuritis comes, it is more commonly seen with an anti-tubercular drug known as ethambutol. Optic neuritis is the main side effect of ethambutol, not isoniazid, but rarely isoniazid can produce optic neuritis. Then we will write hepatotoxicity in fast acetylators. It produces anemia. It produces SLE, systemic lupus erythematosus. It can produce hallucination, which is also known as psychosis, and transient memory loss in brain. Okay, so remember this transient memory loss. It can produce thrombocytopenia. It can produce arthralgia, joint pain. And which anti-tubercular drug can cause gynecomastia? That is isoniazid. Okay, isoniazid. Now, let's move ahead. Let's come to the second drug, a very important drug, that is rifampicin. Now, rifampicin is under a group of drug known as rifamycins, and in rifamycins, apart from rifampicin, we have many drugs like rifabutin, rifapentin, etc., rifaximin, many drugs which we will be discussing. Now we will write that rifampicin, what is the mechanism of action? The mechanism of action of rifampicin is rifampicin in TB bacteria inhibit one enzyme required for DNA replication. Rifampicin inhibit RNA polymerase. Because of this reason, it inhibit RNA synthesis. It inhibits RNA synthesis. Hence, the bacteria will not able to divide. Now, what is the cause of resistance due to rifampicin? This RNA polymerase in a bacteria is produced by a gene known as RPOB gene. The cause of resistance to rifampicin is due to mutation in RPOBG. So a different type of RNA polymerase will be formed. Okay. Now, what is the prevalence of resistance? What is the prevalence of resistance to isoniazid and rifampicin? The prevalence of resistance to isoniazid is 1:10^8. That means 1 tuberculi bacteria in this. Rifampicin, 1:10^6. Now, let's see the uses of rifampicin. Now, rifampicin, it is used in, we will write a mnemonic, TB, LAMS. So, rifampicin, it is the drug of choice for TB. It is also the most effective drug for the treatment of leprosy. Okay. It is used in anthrax, but not the drug of choice. For anthrax, the drug of choice is penicillin for treatment. And for prophylaxis, we give doxycycline. Then it is given for meningitis prophylaxis. Remember, for the treatment of meningitis, the drug of choice is third generation cephalosporins like ceftriaxone, cefotaxime, etc. It is given for brucellosis. And lastly, it is given in Staphylococcus aureus, especially in cases of cellulitis infection. And remember, it is effective in resistant case of Staph aureus known as MRSA. That is methicillin resistant Staph aureus as well. Now let's talk about the properties, pharmacokinetic properties of rifampicin. Okay. Now, rifampicin is a CYP enzyme inducer. It induces all CYP enzyme. Because of this reason, it will increase the metabolism of all drugs, and the effect of all drugs will reduce. Second point, we will write that rifampicin is also P glycoprotein inducer. Now, P-glycoprotein is a transporter which is present in various cells of the body like GIT cells, kidney, blood-brain barrier, lymphocytes, etc. Now, what is the function of P-glycoprotein? P-glycoprotein is an efflux transporter. It causes efflux of a drug so that the drug will not be absorbed and the drug will be rapidly excreted out in urine. So, P-glycoprotein also reduces the effect of drug, because it will not allow a drug to enter into the cell. Example, digoxin. Digoxin is a substrate of P-glycoprotein. And if you will combine rifampicin with digoxin, rifampicin will reduce the absorption of digoxin in GIT and it will promote the excretion of digoxin in urine. Now, what about CYP metabolism? Let's see certain drug interactions. We will write that rifampicin can cause decrease in effect or failure of the effect of all drugs. So let's write certain drugs. VIPE. First is, it decreases the effect of warfarin. Okay, because warfarin is metabolized by CYP. Now, what to do? Use some other anticoagulant. Never combine warfarin, or usually we don't combine warfarin with rifampicin. So you will give some other anticoagulant which is not metabolized by CYP enzyme. So you will give low molecular weight heparin. If you have to give anticoagulant, give low molecular heparin, low molecular weight heparin. Don't give warfarin. Isoniazid. If isoniazid will get rapidly metabolized, it increases the hepatotoxic potential of isoniazid. 3. Protease inhibitor and nevirapine. These are anti-HIV drug. Their effect is also reduced. So if you are giving this anti-HIV drug with rifampicin, we should never combine. We should use some other anti-HIV drug. Now, if you have to combine this anti-HIV drug, you should rather use rifabutin. Because rifabutin is not a CYP inducer. Okay. Lastly, estrogen. It will also decrease the effect of estrogen because estrogen is metabolized by CYP3A4. Hence, rifampicin causes contraceptive failure because estrogen is a contraceptive. Okay. So what to do? If you are giving oral contraceptive pills with rifampicin, either increase the dose of estrogen or use other method of contraception like barrier method, IUCD, etc. If both option will come, this is the best answer. Okay, use some other method of contraception if a female is suffering from tuberculosis and she's taking contraceptive pills, don't give OCP. It's better to give some other method of contraception, or in some cases you can increase the dose of OCP as well. Now, let's talk about the side effects of rifampicin. Okay. Now, the first side effect of rifampicin we will write is, rifampicin causes orange, red color urine. Why? Because rifamycins, they are of orange and red color. The color of rifamycins like rifampicin, rifabutin is orange and red color. And rifampicin causes orange red colored urine. And it is a harmless thing. You should not stop. It is not an indication to stop rifampicin. Rifampicin should be continued. Because rifampicin is coming out in urine, it is harmless. Okay. But there is a drug, we will write rifabutin. Now, rifabutin causes orange, red color skin. Okay. So, it deposits in skin and we confuse whether the patient is suffering from jaundice. It causes pseudo jaundice. Because it is not the accumulation of bilirubin, it is rather the accumulation of rifabutin on skin. Rifabutin deposits in skin, which appears like jaundice. Second point, we will write, rifampicin, just like isoniazid, is hepatotoxic. Okay. And lastly, rifampicin causes hypersensitivity, that is allergic reactions. Okay, now let's see what are the different hypersensitive reactions seen with rifampicin. The first one we will write is flu-like symptoms or flu-like syndrome. Okay, now flu-like syndrome is seen when you give intermittent rifampicin. Okay, you don't give continuously. Second point we will write, it causes cutaneous syndrome, that on skin there will be itching. There is TTP. TTP stands for thrombotic thrombocytopenic purpura. And lastly, rifampicin causes respiratory syndrome. Okay, in respiratory syndrome, it causes breathlessness known as dyspnea, cyanosis, shock, which can lead to death also. Okay, now a very important point, that if the patient is having TTP and if the patient is having respiratory syndrome, if on skin there is thrombotic thrombocytopenic purpura, or if there are the features of respiratory syndrome, it's an indication to stop rifampicin and never start again, because it could be life-threatening. Okay, so respiratory syndrome and TTP is an indication to stop rifampicin. Now let's come to the third drug, that is pyrazinamide. Symbolized by the word Z. Now let's see what is the mechanism of action of pyrazinamide. Pyrazinamide, we will write, this pyrazinamide enters into the TB bacteria, okay, and it becomes converted into active form, and it is converted into active form by certain enzymes. Those enzymes are encoded by a gene known as PNCA gene. So there are certain enzymes produced by the gene. We have named those genes with pyrazinamide, PNCA gene. And after converting into active form, it also inhibits mycolic acid synthesis or cell wall synthesis, just like isoniazid. What is the cause of resistance? The cause of resistance is mutation in PNCA gene. Hence, it will not be converted into active form. Okay. Now, what is the use? The use of pyrazinamide is only and only TB. Apart from TB, it is nowhere used. Let's see the side effects of pyrazinamide. The first side effect you will write is pyrazinamide is hepatotoxic. And we will write it is the most hepatotoxic anti-tubercular drug. Pyrazinamide is the most hepatotoxic. So what are the three hepatotoxic drugs? H, R, Z. So the first three drugs are hepatotoxic. Isoniazid, rifampicin and pyrazinamide. Second point you will write, it causes acute gout, which is also known as hyperuricemia. It increases uric acid level. Now, we will write, because of this reason, the patient will have joint pain or arthritis. And it also causes maximum cases of acute hyperuricemia. Now, which anti-tubercular drug can cause joint pain? We will write, hyperuricemia is seen with pyrazinamide and ethambutol. Pyrazinamide and ethambutol, in all cases, pyrazinamide is the most common culprit or the most dangerous culprit. Okay, both in hepatotoxicity as well as hyperuricemia. Now, last point, we'll write about a drug, ethambutol. Now, what is the mechanism of action of ethambutol? We will write. Ethambutol inhibits one enzyme which is present in the bacteria. It inhibits arabinoacyl transferase enzyme. And just like pyrazinamide and isoniazid, it also inhibits mycolic acid synthesis. Okay, cell wall. Now we will write that this ethambutol is the only first line bacteriostatic drug. It's a bacteriostatic drug in TB. Now, what are the different drugs in TB which are bacteriostatic? We will write. The bacteriostatic drugs in TB are electric, pedal, cycle. So these are the bacteriostatic agent. E for ethambutol, PAS, cycloserine, clofazimine, linezolid, and ethionamide. Okay, So these drugs, this is the complete list of the drugs, which are bacteriostatic. Now let's see what are the properties of ethambutol. Ethambutol is maximum excreted out in urine. Hence, it is the most unsafe anti-tubercular drug in renal failure. Okay. Now, what are the side effects of ethambutol? The first side effect we have already written, it causes acute gout or hyperuricemia. Now, the main side effect of ethambutol comes in eyes. So remember, ethambutol affect eyes. So which anti-tubercular drug have ocular side effect? Ethambutol. Okay. So ocular side effect. Now what it causes in eye? We will write, it causes red, green, color blindness. Okay. It causes red, green, color blindness. It causes scotomas due to damage of optic nerve. And it causes retro, bulbar, optic neuritis. It causes retro, bulbar, optic neuritis. So maximum ocular side effect of anti-tubercular drug comes in eyes is of ethambutol. Now, all these things are the painless loss of vision. As it is a painless loss of vision, a small child will not able to comprehend that he or she is suffering from visual loss. Because of this reason, it is generally avoided in children. Okay? It is avoided in children, but remember, it is not contraindicated. It is just avoided. Okay? So these are the four first line drugs. Now let's talk about supplemental drug, that is streptomycin. Now streptomycin is an aminoglycoside and it is an injectable drug. It is an injectable drug. Now streptomycin, what are the side effects? Streptomycin is nephrotoxic, ototoxic, and it causes neuromuscular blockage. Because of this reason, the muscles will not able to contract. And in ototoxicity, you will write, it is the most vestibulo toxic aminoglycoside. It is the most vestibulotoxic aminoglycoside. It is the most neuromuscular blockage causing aminoglycoside, which is given by injection. And it is least nephrotoxic. Least nephrotoxic aminoglycoside is streptomycin. Okay. Now, let's talk about the comparison of these five drugs. Let's compare these five drugs now. And we will write their short form, HRZES, that is isoniazid, rifampicin, pyrazinamide, ethambutol, and streptomycin. We will write that this isoniazid can kill both intracellular plus extracellular bacteria. Remember, intracellular bacteria is present under macrophages, inside macrophages, while extracellular bacteria is present in cavities. Okay. Again, rifampicin can also kill both intra plus extracellular. Pyrazinamide only kills intracellular bacteria. It cannot kill extracellular. Ethambutol, again, intra plus extracellular. While streptomycin kills only and only extracellular bacteria. It only kills extracellular bacteria. Now these drugs require which medium or pH to produce their effect? Isoniazid, alkaline, ethambutol, alkaline, streptomycin, alkaline, while pyrazinamide, we will write, requires acidic media. Okay, now they kill which type of tubercular bacteria? Pyrazinamide kills mainly rapidly dividing bacteria. Rifampicin can kills sudden the bacteria which becomes suddenly, there is sudden growth spurt. There are certain bacteria which is lying dormant. When they get extra amount of oxygen, there is sudden growth spurt. It will kill spurters as well as dormant bacteria. Okay. Pyrazinamide kills slowly dividing bacteria, which is most dangerous to kill. Pyrazinamide, rapidly. Streptomycin, rapidly. Okay. Now, we will write next point. First point, what is the dose? Dose of isoniazid, we will write 5, 10, 25, 15, 15 milligram per kg. Okay, every dose is in milligram per kg. Okay, now what is the purpose of using all these drugs? Okay, we will write isoniazid to decrease bacterial load. To decrease bacterial load, we give isoniazid. Rifampicin, it increases the effect of isoniazid, because rifampicin and isoniazid is a synergistic combination. Okay, so they are always given together. Pyrazinamide, it kills the most difficult to kill bacteria, which are intracellular and slowly dividing. Hence, the remaining bacteria are killed by pyrazinamide. It has a sterilizing action. Ethambutol is added to prevent emergence of resistance. Emergence of resistance. Okay. Now, streptomycin is just a supplemental drug to them. Streptomycin is a supplemental drug. Okay. Now, among these five drugs, we will write which drug is safest in renal failure. That is rifampicin. If rifampicin is not given in the answer, then the answer is isoniazid, because 70% of this rifampicin is excreted out in bile, while only 30% is excreted out in urine. That is why rifampicin generally does not require even dose reduction in renal failure also. Okay, safest drug in hepatic failure or liver disease is streptomycin. And if streptomycin is not given in the option, we will go by the answer ethambutol. Okay, so can we say that unsafe drug in renal failure will be the last three drug, Z, E, S, and the unsafe drug in hepatic failure will be first three drug, HRZ. Okay, so first three drug are unsafe in hepatic failure. The last three drugs are unsafe in renal failure. Last point, which drug has maximum blood-brain barrier penetration? So which drug was producing CNS side effects, psychosis and hallucination? That was isoniazid. So isoniazid will be having maximum blood-brain barrier penetration. Minimum streptomycin. minimum streptomycin. Okay, so this is the comparison between the first line drug. Now we will write the drug which is contraindicated in pregnancy is streptomycin. And if streptomycin is not given in the answer, we will write pyrazinamide. Okay, and in our country, India and America, India and America, both streptomycin and pyrazinamide are not given in pregnancy. So in treatment of TB in pregnancy becomes HER, HER therapy for 9 months. Okay, so remember. Now, why we are writing streptomycin more contraindicated? Because streptomycin is not given in any country, while in some European nation, they prefer to give pyrazinamide in pregnancy. They give pyrazinamide in pregnancy certain countries. Many countries also don't give pyrazinamide as well. Now, let's talk about second line drugs for TB. So second line drug, as we have discussed, group A drug, they were fluoroquinolones, which we have already discussed. Okay, group B, they were injectable aminoglycoside. Let's talk about group C drug in detail. The first drug in group C is cycloserine. Now we will write cycloserine. What is the mechanism of action? Cycloserine inhibit alanine, racemase, and alanine ligase enzyme. And it also inhibit cell wall synthesis. Now, what are the side effects of cycloserine? Cycloserine produces side effect in CNS. It produces neuropsychosis. In neuropsychosis, you will write it can produce seizures. In psychosis, it can produce suicidal tendencies. Okay. And remember, again, it is producing neurotoxicity just like isoniazid. It is mandatory to give vitamin B6 with cycloserine as well. So which two anti-tubercular drug require vitamin B6 or pyridoxine? Cycloserine and isoniazid. These two anti-tubercular drug requires vitamin B6. Let's talk about second drug. Just one point which is remaining. That if you will combine two molecules of cycloserine together, this drug becomes terazidone. So two molecules of cycloserine combined together becomes terazidone. This terazidone is preferred in cases of genitourinary TB. Why? Because it achieves a very good concentration in urine. Second drug, clofazimine. Clofazimine is also used in leprosy. It is a first line drug for leprosy and it is also used in TB. So these are the two uses of clofazimine. Now what are the side effects of clofazimine? We'll write clofazimine mainly causes discoloration of skin like ichthyosis. It may also cause diarrhea. So this drug is discussed in detail in leprosy part. Third drug, linezolid. Now linezolid inhibit protein synthesis. How? It inhibits one very particular site of ribosome known as 23S subunit of 50S ribosome. and it inhibits the attachment of, by this, it inhibits the attachment of methionine tRNA. Remember, any protein synthesis, the first amino acid in any protein is methionine. So methionine causes initiation of protein synthesis, hence it inhibits initiation. Okay. Now, what is the side effect of linezolid? Linezolid causes thrombocytopenia. And if you are giving linezolid for more than 2 weeks, you have to monitor platelet count. Second point, it increases serotonin level. It may cause serotonin syndrome. Okay. Next drug we will write is ethionamide. Now, what is the mechanism of action of ethionamide? Same like isoniazid. It also inhibits INHA protein, which is required for mycolic acid synthesis. Okay. Hence, ethionamide shows cross resistance of ethionamide is seen with isoniazid. Now, any other drug which show cross resistance, yes, we'll write clofazamine. It shows cross resistance with bidaquiline, which we will be discussing shortly. So, which anti-tubercular drug shows cross resistance with each other? Ethionamide with isoniazid and clofazamine with bidaquiline. Okay. Now, what is the main side effect of ethionamide? Remember, ethionamide, it is derived from a drug known as methimazole. It is a methimazole derivative. That means it's an anti-thyroid drug. It inhibits synthesis of T3 and T3 hormone, T3 and T4 hormone. Hence, ethionamide causes hypothyroidism. And hence, if the level of T3 and T4 will reduce, can we say there will be no negative feedback to TSH hormone? TSH hormone, remember, increases the size of thyroid gland. Hence, with hypothyroidism, there will be goiter. There will be goiter. Okay. So, ethionamide causes hypothyroidism with goiter. Hence, you have to monitor TFT, thyroid function test. Okay. Now, which anti-tubercular drug can cause hypothyroidism? We'll write, most common hypothyroidism is caused by ethionamide. Second is PAS. And very rarely by rifampicin. So, which anti-tubercular drug can cause hypothyroidism? Ethionamide, PAS and rifampicin. Okay. Now, let's talk about a drug, PAS. It is D3 drug, D3 group. PAS stands for para amino salicylic acid. Para amino salicylic acid. And it is a type of sulfonamide. Okay. So, it is a folic acid inhibitor, just like sulfonamide. Okay. Second drug we will write is thioacetazone. Now, remember, thioacetazone nowadays is not used. But we will write thioacetazone is the only anti-tubercular drug which is contraindicated in HIV patients. Which anti-tubercular drug should not be given in HIV patient? Thioacetazone. Because in HIV patient, thioacetazone causes severe allergic rashes. Okay. Now, what are the other drugs? We will write those names like amoxicillin, clavulanic acid, which we have discussed in beta lactams, imipenem, with cilastatin, we have discussed in carbapenem, and the congener of imipenem, meropenem. So these are D3 drugs. Now lastly, D2 drugs. D2 drugs are new drugs for TB. And remember, they are only used as an add-on drug. Only used as an add-on drug, never single. Now, in which case they are used as an add-on drug? They are given in as an add-on drug in cases of MDR and XDR TB. MDR and XDR TB. Now, there are two approved drugs which we will be writing among D3 group. This is a very important group for you, and you will remember their name by heart. The first drug is bedaquiline. Second drug we will write is delamanid. Okay. Now let's see what is their mechanism of action. Bedaquiline inhibit Mycobacterium, which we will write as short form MMIC, Mycobacterium ATP proton pump. So bedaquiline inhibit Mycobacterium ATP proton pump, which is also known as Mycobacterium ATP synthase. Because of this reason, bedaquiline will decrease energy production. Okay, it will not interfere with the cell wall, it will rather decrease energy production. Delaminid is just like metronidazole. It is just like a drug, metronidazole, which has two functions. It inhibits mycolic acid synthesis and it forms nitric oxide, which inhibits DNA, which causes DNA damage. Okay. Which causes DNA damage. So bedaquiline, delaminid. Now we will write both these drugs are given orally, and both these drugs have common side effect. They are hepatotoxic, they increase liver enzymes in the blood, and both these drugs increase QT interval on ECG, okay, which can cause one arrhythmia torsades de pointis. So if QT interval on ECG is very high, don't give this drug. If the QT interval is more than 450 to 500, don't give bedaquiline and delaminid. Now, this bedaquiline, it has been approved, and in many parts of the world it has been given as a drug to treat MDR and XDR TB. Delaminid is still requiring approval, but very soon it will get also approved. Let's see what are the guidelines by which we will prescribe bedaquiline to our patient. Let's make a heading, bedaquiline. Bedaquiline. Okay. Now, bedaquiline, what are the indication? Bedaquiline is only given in people more than 18 years of age. It is only given in cases of pulmonary TB. Okay. It is not given in extra pulmonary TB for a moment. Right now we are not giving. It is not given in patient of TB with HIV. Okay. And it is given above 18 years of age. It is also not given in pregnancy and during lactation. Okay. Second point, we will write, what is the dose and duration of therapy? We'll write, bidaquiline is given as an add-on drug and it is given for 24 weeks. It is given for 24 weeks, which is equal to 6 months. It is only given up to 6 months. How? We will write that in initial 0 to 2 weeks and 3rd to 24th week. In 0 to 2 week, it is given 400 milligram daily. It is given 400 milligram daily. While in 3rd to 24th week, it is given 200 milligram thrice a week. That means every alternative day, 200 milligram thrice a week. Okay. Now how to give? We'll write, bidaquiline is given with food because food increases absorption of bidaquiline. So it should be taken after meals or during meals, not in empty stomach. And bidaquiline should be avoided with, it should be avoided with linezolid. Don't combine bidaquiline with linezolid because it may increase the risk of a disease known as chorioretinitis. Chorioretinitis. And bidaquiline shows cross resistance with clofazimine. Bidaquiline shows cross resistance with clofazimine. So this is all about bidaquiline, and this completes our anti-tubercular drug. Indeed, it is a very important topic. So learn it very in a nice way. So thank you very much.